Let us continue the discussion regarding the protection. The principle of protection we have discussed a little bit. We'll just summarize. Guiding principle is principle of least privilege. We are giving to the users or the processors with the least privileges, so that they are not snatch, use, or access some other processes and users area, right? So programs, users, and systems should be given just enough privileges to perform their task, not all the privileges, right? That limits the damage if entity has a bug and get abused, right? So if at all something went wrong, it should be minimized, right? And whatever the problems may be static during the lifetime of the system or the process, or dynamic, which may change as needed. So domain switching, privilege escalation, all that can be done to protect the system. And need to know a similar concept regarding access of the data. What do you mean by this? Need to know means if someone is accessing data, need to know whether he has that role and the responsibility. So that's what I need to know. We have to a similar concept regarding accessing the data. Now, the important concept what we are going to discuss now is domain of a protection. What do you mean by domain? Domain is, in general, it is area of work, what we call, which domain you are working and all other stuff. So when it comes to protection also, protection can define a domain, right? What is it, how it is done, that we are going to discuss now. So I'll give an elaborated discussion on the screen itself. A computer, all of us know, is a collection of processes and objects. When I say object, it is nothing but both hardware objects as well as software objects, because processes use both hardware and software to continue their execution or performance. So each object has unique name, right, that differentiate it from all other objects in the system, whether it is hardware or a software, and each can be accessed only through well-defined meaningful operations. What do you mean by this? When I say operations, one example is given. The operations that are possible may depend on what object we are going to use or what object we are talking about. For example, a CPU, we can only use it for execution, right? Memory segments can be used for reading and writing. So memory segments can be read and written, right? Program files can be read, written, executed, deleted. So depending upon what we are using, those operations will be performing, right? Another example we can take, that say for example a CD-ROM or a DVD-ROM can only be read, right? The tape drives can be read, written, and rewinded if needed. Fine. So operations depends on what object we are going to do. Another example you can take, like data files can be created. We are talking about the files. Files can be created. If a file is created, that can be opened, that can be read, you can write to the file, those can be closed, deleted. Similarly, similar as the data files, we can have program files also can be read, written, executed, deleted. So operations depend on what object we are using, right? So every operation and every object can be uniquely identified, right? See, every object has a unique name, right? And every object have well-defined and meaningful operations, whether it is a process or a hardware, right? Now, let us talk about the process. A process should be allowed to access only those resources for which it has authorization. It is as simple as that. If a process has access to certain area of the application, only that area must be allowed to access it. No other area of that entire application should be touched, used, or accessed, right? Simple example can be given. In a university database, student has different authorization, right? Exam section has different authorization, wherein account section has different authorization, right? Student can access only if at all, say he's a part of some program and he can access files related to that particular course, right? When it comes to results, he can only read the results. He cannot have other operations on that process. So like that, we can have only authorized people with proper authorization and authentication can access the resources, right? At any time, the process should be able to access only those resources that are currently required to complete the task. The processes should not should not hold few resources with it and keep asking for some other resources, which we have seen when we are discussing about deadlocks, right? Keeping one or two resources with us and trying to gain access to some other resources which is being held by someone else. And I say someone, some other process. So that should be avoided. So a process should be able to access only those resources that it currently requires to complete its task. So this particular second requirement, commonly referred as need to know, which I was talking about, need to know principle. Principle is useful in limiting amount of damage if a faulty process can cause to the system, if at all it has entered into the system. Now, let us try to understand the structure of the domain. What do you mean by structure of the domain and what it is? Protection domain specifies resources, very simple, resources that process may access. Say for example, there is a process which wants printer. So that particular resource has the access to printer, right? As simple as that. Each domain defines a set of objects and type of operations that may be invoked on those objects. Say for example, there is one object. For that object, we are defining different types of operations. For example, there is a data file. What operations are possible on the data file? Read, write, execute, delete, append. So what type of operations we are going to perform on that particular object, that must be defined. So that forms the domain. So each domain defines set of objects followed by types of operations on that each object, right? Then access right. Access right is ability to execute an operation on an IC. See, we have multiple operations. Access right defines, okay, only read. That is your access right. Only append. You cannot write in between, only add at the end. So that is access right. So this is how access rights are defined. Then a domain is defined as a set of object. This is how it is defined. A set. But between these angular brackets. So we will define what object it is, what access right or a set of access rights it has, right? This pair defines domain, right? As shown in the next slide, we'll see. Note that some domains may be disjoint while others may overlap. Here is a simple example. Object name, as I said, and rights set. For example, D1, this is one domain. D2 another domain, D3 third domain, right? We have defined few objects, object 1, 2, 3, year 2, 4, whatever objects, right? In domain 1, object 1 has these two access rights. Object 2 has only execute. Object 3 has read and write. It does not have execute. Whereas domain 2 has, in domain 2, the same object has only write. Here it has execute, here it is write. Here and here in domain 3, object 1 and object 3. Object 1 has execute, here it is not. Object 3 has read, here it is not. It is there, right? So this is what we call it as overlapping, right? This is disjoint overlap, right? What happens in domain D2 as well as D3, object 4 has access right print, right? in both the domains, domain 2 and 3, this particular object has print operation. So domain is what? Set of access rights, that's it, right? So this is what the concept of domain and domain structure, right? So the association between the process and the domain may be static or dynamic. If the association is static, then need to know principle requires a way of changing the content domain dynamically. If the association is dynamic, then there is a need of mechanism known as domain switching, right? What this domain switching is, we will see in the later discussion.